Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service today for the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Saving God, whose Son Jesus Christ healed the sick and brought them wholeness of body and mind, inspire us, his disciples, so that we may constantly proclaim his gospel by our words and by the dedication and integrity of our lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings. And if the readers this morning could bring a copy of the pew sheet to read from.
Inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, you speak? O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. For the word of the Lord.
Sing praises to the Lord. reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do of this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under God Christ's law. So that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessing. All the word is the Lord.
Please stand for the break.
Glory.
and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with fever. They told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. The fever left her, and she began to serve him. That evening, at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many of the sick with various diseases, and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. Simon and his companions come before him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let's go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. For the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
As we go out through, move our way through life, sometimes, regardless of when we hear them, there are things that stick in our mind or we remember them really, really well. And today's gospel passage is one of those for me. It was amongst the very first New Testament passages that I studied in my first year of university studying theology. It was second semester, so I wasn't quite at the beginning. And I remember being somewhat stunned when my lecturer talked about Jesus healing this woman and suddenly she's up and serving, because she was quite a strong feminist, even back then, and still is today. And it sounds like a really unnecessary thing for someone who's been made well to suddenly get up and get on with doing their household tasks. Because I don't know about you, but when I've been sick for a long period of time, I still don't really feel like, or I've been really sick even if it's only for a day or two, I don't feel like doing a great deal once I'm starting to feel better. So it feels to us, you know, some 2,000 odd years or so since this moment, a fairly strange sort of passage where our goal is to continue to care for someone who's been sick. But that's actually not what why Mark has recorded the story. And there's a couple of interesting tidbits about this passage that get us thinking. One of which is this is the only passage in the New Testament where we hear that one of the disciples actually is married, has a family, beyond brothers or sisters. It is the only passage that mentions that one of the 12 is more than just a follower of Jesus. And I don't mean that in the pejorative sense, because the Gospels are all about following Jesus. But here, we have Peter's mother-in-law. So therefore, he's married and may well have had children. We don't know. But it's an interesting thing, just for our own personal thinking about how do we respond to God, and really that's what the heart of this passage is about, is responding to God. Not necessarily the things that take place within it, but the responses that people make. So this passage follows on immediately from last Sunday's Gospel reading, which talks about Jesus being in the synagogue and preaching or teaching with an authority that was recognised that was different from those who usually taught. And Mark talks about that being the scribes in that particular synagogue. So he's commanding attention right from the beginning. In the middle of it, you have a man coming forward who's possessed by a demon, the demon proclaiming that Jesus is of God before Jesus casts him out. And then when that's taken place, an even higher sense of Jesus' authority to act over things that he wouldn't have been expected to do. So about health, well-being, people who are possessed, and we hear a lot more of that again in the passage today. And Jesus leaves the synagogue, this is probably in the morning, and people are thinking about him. They are talking about him, what they've seen, what they've heard, and word of mouth goes around the community really quickly. Once the synagogue service is done, they go back to Simon Peter's house. His mother-in-law is really sick. She is bedridden with a fever, which says actually a whole lot more than just she's sick. She can't get up, and a fever in ancient times might have actually pointed towards an illness that someone may not recover from. It's not just, well, we'll go and grab some medicine and you'll be right in a couple of days. This could have been life-threatening. We don't know because Mark doesn't tell us. But the mere fact that she has a fever and is in bed suggests that she is extremely unwell and not able to do what would normally be expected of her. When Jesus sees her and is brought into her, he takes her by the hand and lifts her up, and she's fine. So well, so almost instantaneously, it's as if she had not been sick at all. And therefore, is able to fulfill her role as an important woman in the household and then care for those who have come in to offer hospitality, to serve, do all of those things that were part of the normal expectation of a woman within a household in Jerusalem or in Galilee at that time, 2,000 years ago. She is better. No ifs, buts, or anything else. She is completely recovered and not just recuperating, but well as if she had not been ill. That in itself is another one of these powerful moments where, pardon me, where we see Jesus at work bringing something of God into a house and people are benefiting from it. By the end of the Sabbath, once sundown has come around, the Sabbath is over, everybody who's heard about Jesus from those who are in the synagogue that morning who are unwell in any way whatsoever are brought to the door or make their way to the door of the house, and Jesus heals them also. We see this spreading out really, really quickly of Jesus' message, his authority, and his ability to make a difference to the lives of people almost instantaneously. Of course, there's a cost to this. And as a part of responding to that personal cost to Jesus as a person, he needs to restore himself. And he goes off to pray well before anybody else is likely to be out of bed and be with God in that sense of restoration or recreation of his ability to be his normal self, to go on with what life is about to ask of him, to fulfill the ministry that God the Father has brought him into. The disciples do not understand this in any way, shape or form. Why would you wander off in the dark by yourself, type of thing? But as we will see, or we will see, when we continue to read through Mark or any of the other Gospels for that matter, Jesus will at times disappear for a bit to draw himself back into God fully and completely to be able to continue on with his ministry. And it's here for us today that I believe is the heart of what this passage is about. It is a reminder to us, all of us, regardless of what our lives look like, how busy they are or not, whether we've got responsibilities or not, whether we're unwell or not, that we are all called and invited into being with God. That is the point of the journey of faith. It is about coming into that moment in time, amen, where we are to be at one with God, so that we too are restored or recreated to be the people that God wants us to be. Being here in worship, whether it be for a Eucharist or anything else, on a Sunday morning or at any other time, is a part of that drawing into God and being made open to what God is saying to us, and going on with the rest of our lives restored and fulfilled in being able to do what God wants of us and what faith calls us to be. It's also a bit more than that. We're talking about our prayer lives. We're talking about that sense of not just chatting to God or talking to God or laying down all of those concerns which we have in our lives to place them into God's care, but to stop, to listen, to hear what God may or may not be saying to you and I. For without that two-way conversation, we're kind of missing the point. Faith is not just something we do, it is something we live, it is a relationship with God that we have right throughout our lives that grows and changes and develops over time. If we were to stop and think of other relationships that we have, be it a marriage or a close friendship, what happens if the conversation stops in a marriage or a close friendship? They die. Or they stop growing at the very least. But by and large, life within them stops. It is no different with God. You and I are called into that deep and abiding relationship that is faith. And we need to be open to what God is saying to us, and not just talking so that God can't get a word in edgewise. This is what Jesus is doing in the latter part of this gospel passage. He is opening himself up fully and completely to God for that restoring, that enabling, that bringing forth in full life that Jesus needs to be to go on with his ministry. And as we see at the end of the passage, Jesus is able to do that. He goes to a number of towns and villages, perhaps small cities, and proclaims the message that he has about God. The word goes on ahead of him, and people are more than likely looking forward to him arriving in their community, so that they too can be fed spiritually, can be healed if they need it, or have their demons cast out and their life restored, so that they too are fully open to God. Each and every day, that's our call. That's our responsibility in life, to be open to that place of God within us, that we too may share that knowledge, that love, that understanding that gives us life with those around us. And while the healing is an important part of this story, it's the lead up to the heart of what's going on. That is, we are all called to be open to God and what God desires of us and for us. The Lord be with you. If you'd stand, please. Let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the world and for the church.
Praise to you, faithful God, for you hear the prayers of your people and answer when we call on you. We pray for your creation, for a sense of wonder and delight at its beauty, for wisdom and justice in the use of its bounty. We pray for all peoples, for an end to violence, oppression, and for the seeking of peace and harmony in our world. We entrust to you tender care of the people of Congo, Sudan, Ethiopia, Yemen, Palestine and Israel, Ukraine and Russia. We pray for doctors, nurses, and for all who are caring for those in war zones throughout our world, and for a fair and equitable distribution of medical resources to those places. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Praise to you, faithful God, for you have called us by our name and brought us into the company of all believers. We pray for your church, for a community open to the movement of your Spirit, for a passion to proclaim your gospel in the world. Within the Anglican Church of Australia, we pray today for Bishop Gary Bellbrook, for the clergy and people of the Diocese of Ballarat. We pray for the Very Reverend Michael Davies and for the clergy and people of Christchurch Cathedral. Within our own diocese, we pray for our Bishop Clarence, and today for the parochial district of Alpa, for priest in charge, Canon Moira Evers, and for the parish leaders and congregations of All Saints, Bright, St. Elfrida's, Harrietville, St. Paul, Milford, and St. John's, Warrawee. Lord, in your mercy. Praise to you, faithful God, for you welcome the outcast, bring strength to the weary, and your love for your people is steadfast, fast and sure. We pray for all who live and work in our community, praying especially for emergency workers, for members of the police force, for CFA, SES and ambulance services, and for all volunteer emergency organisations. Praying especially in our local community for the work of Lowe's and Fisher's Christians Caring. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Praise to you, faithful God, for you cure the sick, bind up the brokenhearted, and bring life and wholeness to your people. We pray for all in anxiety, pain, and grief, for comfort, for the sorrow, suffering and peace for the dying. We remember those on our parish list of prayer and for all who we know personally in need of your healing touch. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Praise to you, faithful God, for you have broken the bonds of death and promised to your people the joys of everlasting life. We give you thanks for all who have followed your way of love, for those from this parish whose years have mine before us this week. We pray that we may share with them in the joy of your resurrection life. Lord, in your mercy.
God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Just before I invite you to stand for the peace, I just need to point out there's a slight mistake in the next hymn, a very odd word that popped up. In verse 3, it's in the second line, you'll see it says, each with a fist that we can alone bring. That's actually gift. So, fist does not make any sense whatsoever. So, when you come to verse 3, please keep in mind where it says fist actually equals gift, and it will make a whole lot more sense than what's written there. Please stand. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us share with one another a sign of God's peace.
Thank you.
praise and thanksgiving. In the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Blessed be God forever. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. My arms stretch out, lifting me high. Look to the Lord and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who find shelter in the Holy One. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. My arms stretch out, lifting me high. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Glory and honour be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Saviour Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, supper he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Is one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise. confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share in the one bread.
stand. Let us pray. God of the nations, we thank you for nourishing us with this holy sacrament. Guide us by your presence, that we may bring your light to those who dwell in darkness, and establish your justice in the earth. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us now with the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise. Please be seated. There are a few things that do need to be brought to your attention today around the life of the parish. The Friends of the Cathedral AGM will be this afternoon at 2 o'clock in Pembury Hall. Parish Council, for those who are on Parish Council, meets next Sunday at 12. And it's almost Lent upon us already. It's Easter's quite early this year. Shrove Tuesday is on the 13th, so Tuesday week, and there will be a blessing of the ashes after they've been burnt, pardon me, for use on Ash Wednesday, followed by a pancake afternoon tea at 3:30, which is a reminder that Ash Wednesday will be the following day, and those services are 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. For both of those services. As Lent is upon us, study groups available again. I'm not sure if there's a list of which name down on or not, but there is information about that. First choral evening something here is in the fortnight at 5 o'clock. Would you like to say something about the music here? Or... No? Fine. And next Sunday with Farmers Market there will be, can't remember the right term, but there will be the concerts during the morning. I'll leave the rest to you. I don't know if I can put my Anglicare hat on for a sec. We are in need of empty egg cartons, so if you've got a couple, just the dozen, not the dozen and a half like we've seen in our house, we would really appreciate if you could pop those in the Anglicare loaves and fishes tub over the next few weeks, because we've got a lot of eggs this week, but no egg cartons, so it's hard to give them away without egg cartons. If you'd stand for our final hymn, please.
Christ, the Son of God, be manifest to you, that your lives may be a light to the world.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and every day. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Almighty God,
Your Apostle James encouraged the sick to call for the elders of the church, that they might pray over them and anoint them with oil. Grant that Julian and Margaret, who are anointed with this oil, may be strengthened by your Holy Spirit, healed and restored through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Julian, I anoint you with oil in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Margaret, I anoint you with the oil in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As you are outwardly anointed with this holy oil, so may our Heavenly Father grant you the inward anointing of the Holy Spirit. Of his great mercy, may he forgive you your sins, release you from suffering, and grant you wholeness and health. May he deliver you from all evil, preserve you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Julian, I lay my hands on you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, asking our Lord Jesus Christ to sustain you with his presence, to drive away all sickness of body and spirit, and to give you the victory of life and peace, which will enable you to serve him both now and forevermore. Amen. Margaret, I lay my hands on you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, asking our Lord Jesus Christ to sustain you with his presence, to drive away all sickness of body and spirit, and to give you the victory of life and peace, which will enable you to serve him both now and forevermore. Amen. Almighty Lord, who is a strong tower to all who put their trust in him, to whom all things in heaven, on earth and under the earth bow and obey, be now all and evermore your defence, and make you know and feel that the only name under heaven given for health and salvation is the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.